program, so I'd encourage you all to sit down and begin to get into the discussion. Thank you. Welcome, everyone, to today's panel discussion on New York City quality of life issues, hosted by the Manhattan Institute's New York City social media newsletter, The Beat, as part of the Manhattan Institute's Quality of Life Week. The Beat has featured topics like the quality of public spaces and the positive effects of proactive policing from both a statistical and an anecdotal perspective. The New York City of recent years is a far cry from the dirty, seemingly ungovernable city of the early 1980s and 1990s. Due in large part to the policy initiatives of the past 20 years, those of us who remember the 2000 murders that plagued New York in 1990 have learned to breathe a little easier walking home at night. It took a lot of effort to reclaim New York's public spaces, but it worked. And any of us who would be surprised today to go on a subway covered in graffiti or see a drug dealer selling crack on the Bryant Park lawn. That being said, there are signs that law and order is beginning to fray around the edges again, as broken windows policing has gone out of style with those too young to remember the Crown Heights riots. A lack of concern for public order has left a void that could allow crime and disorder to creep back in. Here to discuss these and a host of other quality of life issues are NYPD Commissioner Bill Bratton, MI Senior Fellow Fred Siegel, Senior Advisor to Mayor Bill de Blasio Phil Walczak, and MI Senior Fellow Jason Riley. So I'm pleased to turn the discussion over now to the moderator of our discussion, New York anchor, Errol Booth.
Thank you, Larry, and good morning to all. Let me tell you how we're gonna start this conversation and the point at which you'll be welcome to join us in this conversation. For the next 45 minutes or so, we on the stage will have a conversation about some of the issues that Larry touched on and which broadly get lumped together under quality of life. As you know, many people interpret this stuff differently. It's a policing strategy, it's a consumer complaint, it's an obligation for government, it's a form of political engagement. There are a lot of different things that people mean. If we can straighten out some of that and talk about it in a way that's useful and helpful, we will have accomplished what I hope to accomplish in the next 45 minutes. I should mention that the press was told that there will be an availability by the panelists after the panel ends. And so at 1:15, as we're breaking up, you'll be able to ask your questions. However, prior to that, as we go about a half an hour to 40 minutes in, we're going to open the discussion to questions, but those are going to be non-press questions initially. That'll be for the members of the audience who are here, and then press folks, you'll get all the time you need with, or as much as they allow you to have, afterwards when we have an availability. So with all of that in mind, let me start by asking Commissioner Bratton, just because it's on everybody's mind. We've heard for so many years, Commissioner, that quality of life policing rests on the insight and the assumption that if you can find and pay closer attention to small violations, you can leverage and prevent much larger problems. Because it's on everyone's mind, is there a nexus to counterterrorism work that quality of life policing and strategies would be part of the toolkit to help keep the city safe?
There actually is, and let me give you a very clear example about the idea of quality of life, broken windows policing, which is an element of quality of life, and then the question you just asked about, does it have a nexus to counterterrorism? Broken windows policing is based on the idea that if you take care of the small things, you prevent many of them from becoming big things. Weed the garden, won't kill the flowers or even the biggest trees. Deal with small crime, and by deterring the small crime, you prevent it from going to bigger crime. In the instance of terrorism, we're clearly seeing that young people in particular, and this is what we're dealing with in great numbers, people in their teens and into their 20s, can become radicalized very, very quickly through social media in particular, and the jihadists have become expert at the use of social media to recruit and radicalize, because so many of our young people live on these devices. And And so with this quality of life, open windows, the idea of focusing on the little thing, is the idea of us trying to encourage parents, others, to watch for change in behavior, that little change in behavior that is the beginning of that radicalization, the idea of what sites are they visiting? Are they now, in the case of so much of this is in terms of Islamic radicalization on the issue of religion, are there dramatic changes that are occurring in your child or a young person's lifestyle and focus? And if so, get in there before they become radicalized, because we have had almost no success at de-radicalization once they've gone over. And so it's like dealing with the cancer, get it early, because once the full-blown cancer occurs, it is so much more difficult, and in some instances almost impossible to get them back.
Luca, when you describe it, I assume that you need to enlist or even rely upon family members and others with intimate knowledge of where people are web surfing and so forth. This isn't like stopping a turnstile, gentlemen.
That's correct. It's whether it's teachers in school, counselors, coaches on a team, family members, the expansion, see something, will say something. You know, your teacher in school, you see there's a change in behavior of a child, dress starting to occur, having a discussion with the parents. The guy about what's going on with your child's life. It's the same thing as dealing with a child that's moving toward drug addiction. That there's changes in behavior that oftentimes are occurring very rapidly that can't be ignored and need to be addressed.
Okay. Phil Wolzak, let me ask you, just because this was also in the news, there was the announcement yesterday that there will be 15,000 units of supportive housing built over the next 10 to 15 years. I'm curious as to how the administration thinks of quality of life beyond questions of policing, because sort of life on the streets, life in the city, is sort of one of the other key meanings that's attached to that phrase.
Well, I can tell you that this mayor and the administration in its entirety takes these issues of these quality of life issues very, very seriously. And I think yesterday's announcement is one example. There's been a great amount of dialogue about homelessness over the past year, especially in New York City. And for example, this administration has put forth a four-year, $1 billion plan designed to get people off the streets and then out of shelter in permanent housing through a number of different ways, tenant protection, eviction protection, and so forth. The announcement yesterday on 15,000 for supportive housing is part of that approach. The idea is to, for those who are struggling with homelessness, to have the best path or permanent pathways out of homelessness. And many folks identify supportive housing as just that. So, but there are other elements as well, other issues that are important to that. Policing certainly and homelessness. But there are also factors as well that how the economy is doing. Right now, period, we're seeing large job expansion in New York City. We're seeing a record number of tourists come to New York City, which is a key part of our economic growth. So there are a lot of different factors, but I can say that at the top, and in many of the commentary about quality of life, there's always been a point back to 20 years ago, 25 years ago, and how things were then. And the mayor, I can tell you, he said this in an editorial a few months back, has made a solemn pledge to assure that on his watch, those days will never return in New York City. That's a very serious promise.
Okay, I'm gonna read a letter to you from the today's edition of the Daily News. And it's a bit of a rant, but you may have heard that from time to time from the citizens of New York. And I'd like you to, you know, just kind of respond. What would you tell this person,
sure,
if she were to stop down the street? Well, Tuesday, while walking my three-year-old daughter to art class at 4:30 p.m., I saw a homeless woman in a wheelchair aggressively panhandling, benches full of homeless, and three men pouring alcohol into red cups, all within a block of the West 72nd Street subway station. In our neighborhood in the West 60s, there are six homeless people who are now regularly sleeping on the streets who weren't there before August. Something massive and scary is happening, and we have an incompetent leader who has proven himself totally unable to address the quality of life issues in our city. Mayor de Blasio needs to realize that our city does not naturally find itself in homeostasis. Any peace and order that exists is the result of a tremendous amount of effort and pushback against the chaos that would otherwise exist. Clean streets, good jobs, excellent schools, litter-free and homeless-free streets, these things don't just happen. De Blasio needs to get his act together to ensure the city doesn't fall apart on his watch. And we New Yorkers need to be aggressively seeking and supporting an alternate candidate to be our next mayor. So, as I said, a little over the top, the conclusions, you know, obviously are, you know, this is somebody who had a bad day and found her way to the keyboard. But what do you say to people when they're saying things like, you know, something massive and scary is happening?
Well, I think that perhaps not a 2017 voter, but I would say that, for us that is, I would say that over the past just year and a half, as a result of what our administration has done on the homelessness issue, we've seen 20,000 people move out of shelter into permanent housing. We've seen 20 plus homeless encampments across the city under bridges and kind of hidden away places in tandem with PD and DHS, working to clear out those areas and remove people from those areas, but also to connect them to services they need. As I said before, it's about permanent pathways to serve people so that there isn't this cycle of moving off a corner and coming right back, or being completely dispassionate toward real needs of people who are in trouble. As I said, this administration is actually spending more money on the supportive housing initiative than ever before. Our investments are higher than past administrations, something we take very, very seriously. And there is a robust plan to address all these kinds of issues. But we want to do it in a way that is long-term, permanently successful. And that's why the policies that we have are designed to prevent homelessness from happening in the first place through tenant protection, eviction protection, putting people on a plan if they're in shelter to get into permanent housing, and supporting them if they have mental health or addiction problems. That's holistic. And we have to also understand that these are deep-rooted issues that have been in the city and across the country for many years. I think I saw a stat that homelessness has increased over 20 years by about 115%. So it is a problem that's happening in a lot of places, but we do have a clear plan and a clear vision, and real resources, and a real cross-agency approach to get real results.
Okay. I mean, one of the things, I live about four blocks from one of the big homeless shelters in Oakland, and whenever people say, oh, it's so scary, I say, well, imagine how you feel if you were living in there. That's got to be pretty scary, too. Fred Siegel, for historical perspective, you know, this notion that people will often default back to life in 1990, you know, and that's where we're heading back to, where if it gets frayed around the edges, that's clearly the direction that we're going to end up in. You've seen and written about and studied the city before, during, and after that period. How should we be using history to sort of inform the conversation today?
Carefully. Obviously, there are enormous changes. We created 20,000 jobs last year. That's very good. Commissioner Bratton has kept crime at a remarkably low level. Crime, but what's returned is menacing homelessness. It's the sense of menace that's returned that has so many people unnerved. And the people who most produce the menace are the mentally ill homeless. And unfortunately, the Blasio administration has not addressed that population. The double diagnosis people, both alcoholic and drug users. They're frightening to people in the way they behave. They're erratic, unpredictable. We have Kendra's Law, but the administration hasn't used Kendra's Law. Kendra's Law allows someone to require a treatment, mandatory treatment, when they're kept at home for 6 months. But only about half the people eligible for Kendra's Law have had Kendra's Law applied to them. It saves a lot of money, Kendra's Law, because people don't go into shelters. But you know, I'm not criticizing the investment in housing, etc., etc. Some of that may turn out well. We'll see. But if you don't deal with these dual diagnosis people who absorb an enormous amount of police time, you know, they end up in Rikers Island, they end up if they're not in the homeless shelter. And the policeman has to act as a welfare worker when they should be dealing with other matters.
When you see the poll suggesting that white voters are getting disillusioned or impatient with the administration, is that the source of it, do you think, or is there something
else?
Yes,
I think that's the source of it, but not just white voters. It's largely across the board, but most intense among white voters. Yes, there's just no, the lady you read is typical of people across the city who don't understand. Where are these people come from? Why can't anyone do anything about them? It's not like the drug, when Commissioner Bratton first came into office, there was, 3 blocks from my house, an 24-hour open-air drug market. And it made people crazy. Everyone knew where it was. And two months after Commissioner Bratton came in, I remember walking down that street. Something's wrong here. I'm missing something. It was gone. It never came back. Now some of those guys went indoors, but it was better. If we don't deal with the seriously mentally ill, the city won't feel at ease again.
Mm-hmm. And Jason, you've talked about how. This isn't just, say, the Upper West Side, where people are getting a little freaked out.
I agree. The letter writer, I believe, is very representative of the sentiment in the city. And I'd add that the mayor's office has been in complete denial about this problem up until very recently. The press has pushed this. The New York Post was pushing it for months. The Times followed suit. Now the pollsters are showing that people in New York see this as a problem. Now the mayor has decided to act. And I agree with Fred, they're targeting largely the wrong problem, which is not capacity per se. You have to remember, even the numbers that are reported on homelessness, they're talking about people in shelters. They're not even talking about people sleeping on the street, which is what the letter writer was getting at. Those people aren't counted in the official numbers. And not even all shelter people are counted. There are a lot of battered women's shelters that aren't counted, children's shelters are not counted. What people want are those people off the street. And providing more capacity will not alleviate that problem unless you can forcibly remove these people from the street. The mentally ill, the drug addicts, and so forth. And this mayor has hired someone to be in charge of homelessness who has been an activist lawyer in protecting the right of people not to enter shelters. So it tells you how even the solution, now that he's finally gotten around to admitting there's a problem, is unlikely to do much to alleviate the problem.
Well, in part because I don't want us to all just beat up Phil, but in part because there's an important distinction to be made between perception and reality, right? I mean, if what is being attempted now with the 15,000 units and some of the other strategies is necessary but not sufficient, that is something that the media, the editorial boards should take notice of, right?
It won't hurt, as Fred said, it won't help hurt to increase capacity. But I don't think it's going to get at the root problem that the letter writer was describing. Could I also piggyback on something the commissioner said earlier about radicalization? We're having a big debate in the country right now over this refugee situation in Syria and whether states want to take these folks back in. But from my reporting and talking to Homeland Security folks, their much bigger concern is not a fake refugee coming in. It's what the commissioner was talking about. Long-term residents of the United States who become radicalized after they've been here for a number of years. That fits the profile of the Boston Marathon bombers. It fits the profile of the would-be Times Square bomber. Even the four-foot shooter was an American citizen. A radicalization. It's no longer uncommon to read stories about teenage Americans being caught at the airport trying to run off and join jihad. And that is what concerns most a lot of the people who think about homeland security. And that gets to what's going on here in New York, where we had in place a quite robust counterterrorism surveillance program that this mayor, a year after the Boston Marathon bombing, officially shut down.
Let me interject right now on that issue. This mayor did not do that. This commissioner did that. This commissioner did that. That unit you were talking about was down to 2 or 3 officers who were not even performing that function. This myth that Kelly, Commissioner Kelly, had this huge apparatus that was focused on the mosque and the Muslim community. Let's get beyond it. I'm tired of hearing it. Blaming de Blasio, I'm the police commissioner. I did away with the unit. Informed the mayor I did away with the unit. Why? Because it was totally dysfunctional and not performing any useful function in the counterterrorism realm. So since I'm taking responsibility for it, it accused me of it. The mayor was informed of it. This keeps coming up over and over again in the tabloids. Let's get real about this issue.
Commissioner, let's straighten it out. I mean, I talked with your predecessor
this
about
this. This is the opportunity to do that.
Yeah, let's do it. The demographics.
It's urban legend. It's urban myth.
The demographics unit was intended to sort of go out and sort of broadly survey communities so that, for example, if there's a question about Syrians, whatever the question is, well, where do the Syrians in New York live? Where do they socialize? Where do they worship? Where do they live? And so there was that level of sort of analysis. And along with it, you know, or in order to do it properly, people would go to cafes and they would ask a couple of questions and they would get around. Now, how it was portrayed and what led to the reporting and the Pulitzer Prize, Kelly's reaction, that's history now. As far as you're concerned, though, does the function still need to be staffed and maintained, and if so, how?
The function is done in many other ways, and it's one of the reasons why Commissioner Kelly, you're going to have to ask him why, if it was so essential to fighting terrorism, did he allow it, during his time as commissioner, to dwindle from 13 or 14 down to when we came in, there were either two or three, and the reason I don't know the exact number, because I think one was off doing something else. And if I believe my chief of intelligence, Chief Galati, was testifying to this in court on various court cases, that not one single piece of actionable intelligence ever came out of that unit in its years of existence. So is that an appropriate use of a dozen police detectives who are supposed to be helping in the fight against terrorism if not a single piece of actionable intelligence came out of their multi-years of work?
Well,
so I said, what I suggest on this issue is go talk to Commissioner Kelly and ask him why during his time the unit was removed from, decreased from its zenith, 12 to 16 officers, to when we came through the door.
Well, the threat too has evolved in the past year. We've seen the rise of the Islamic
State. And we're addressing those threats in many other ways.
We know they are now striking in the West in places like Paris. And so, given, and we also know, as you mentioned in your initial comments, their savviness with social media and recruiting people here in the United States, is there any sense that it should be rethought, this program?
Not at all. We have the most robust counterterrorism entity in the United States, New York City, necessity, that apart from the current concern about the most recent video threat, there's a constant threat to New York City. That's a reality. That's why we have 1,000 personnel that we've put in there by Commissioner Kelly during his creation of that robust counterterrorism component. It's why over the last year or so, with the approval of this mayor and city council, we increased the size of the department that had declined by 6,000 officers in the face of all this threat. Now, for the first time in 14 years, the department is growing. And where are a lot of those officers going? 523 of them are going into this new counterterrorism unit that will be a full-time unit, highly trained, equipped to defend and to go on the offense if attack were to occur. So we are constantly adjusting our counterterrorism capabilities to the changing threat. So the issue of social media, the growth since ICES, just the 2 years I've been police commissioner, ICES has really morphed into the leading terrorist organization in the world in those 2 years. So during my time as commissioner, we are reshaping the counterterrorism capabilities of the department to meet the threat that now exists. And what I'm saying to you as commissioner, to deal with the threat as we understand it, I have no need to recreate a unit, the demographic unit, that didn't serve a particularly useful function then, and in my mind, at this time, would serve an even less significant function. I'd rather have those 12 detectives doing social media analysis, who's talking to who. So we're constantly adjusting our resources. So what I'm saying, we need to get off of this thing about this demographic unit. It's all tied up in the courts anyway. let's move on. It's if it ever had a useful function, best I can tell, it didn't. Not a single actual piece of intelligence, according to the chief who ran the unit throughout its history and who had no qualms of doing away with it. No, I'm sorry. I guess I don't see the need to even talk about it anymore.
So, Phil, when quality of life gets mentioned, and as in the letter that I read, when people are treating it on the side of citizens as an emergency or a potential emergency, is that how it's interpreted inside City Hall?
It's interpreted as very serious and requiring the full attention of the mayor and the entire administration. We have just put forth major, major investments that haven't been made before at a lot of different levels to address these issues. The mental health conversation was being discussed a few moments ago. The administration is on the cusp of introducing a new mental health roadmap in the coming next few days, a short period of time here, maybe a little bit longer. But we did release a report showcasing that 20% of folks have some sort of mental health problem. So we're working on identifying the problem, communicating that problem to folks, and then following that up with an aggressive plan to provide help and support. Supportive housing, which has been, I think, a little downplayed on this panel here, the whole point is to provide people with mental health services who need them in the midst of a real vacuum of that kind of housing. So the issues that are being discussed in this panel, and to say that the administration is not taking them seriously or not supporting them with dollars or smart plans or new programming or innovative ideas, is this not backed up by the reality?
Not addressed by the mental health plan, as has been foreshadowed so far. We have talked about people who are sad, percentage of the people who are walking around the city. The problem is not sad people. The problem is this very small, defined population that's very difficult to deal with, that takes up a disproportionate amount of police time, and has the worst effect on people's sense of the city. If you have a guy in your corner, who's leering at your baby as you come by in the stroller and asking the baby, this I've actually seen, asking the baby for change. I don't know what that was about. The mother freaked out. You haven't, the city has not addressed this, and it has to.
Look, I think a mistake that the administration made early on was not, if you will, validating what we all were seeing. The problem was increasing. And so for a period of time, by not admitting what everybody was seeing and feeling, including myself, my neighborhood, as police chief, police commissioner, as you all well know, this is an area I focus on, quality of life, and dealing effectively with it. So the frustration I have as a police commissioner this time, that I did not have in 90 in the subway system, and then a 94 as police commissioner, is the rules of the game have changed and changed dramatically. That we now have court decisions that significantly limit the ability of my police officers to address these issues of concern and frustration, even those that involve that 40% of the street population that we believe are emotionally disturbed, and that 5% or so that are significantly emotionally disturbed. There are constant court initiatives to protect the rights of the homeless to be on the streets that we have to go with the law. So, for example, in the city of New York, if somebody wants to sit on a box on a city street with a sign begging, constitutionally protected, also protected by New York laws that say that is freedom of speech. And the law I used to be able to use was blocking free foot passage. Move along. You're blocking pedestrian free foot passage. That has been overturned. If you can walk around them, then it's determined that they are not blocking your free foot passage. That's the rules we work with that I didn't have to work with in 94. If somebody is lying on the street, if they're lying on a piece of cardboard on a subway grate, can't do anything with them. However, if they're lying in a box on the subway grate in the street, I can, in fact, then move them along. That's the nuances of the law that my cops have to deal with. In terms of dealing with the emotionally disturbed, our officers have two options. They can arrest for certain offenses, or they can remove the person to the hospital. We've been increasingly trying to go the more humane route because clearly these people are not capable of caring for themselves. They are, their behavior is erratic, they're off their meds, and we will take them to the hospitals. There are two things underway in the medical community of great significance at this time. Doctors' reluctance to commit under Kendall law or by any law to commit somebody to a facility where they're going to be restrained. So that's one element of it. So as soon as we bring them in, they get analyzed, they give them a few meds, and then the next day they're back out. Secondly, there are so few beds, if you will, or facilities for these people, even if the doctor were of mind to put them in there, and not be concerned about lawsuits and being sued, that we have at this particular time is something the administration is trying to address, increasing the number of facilities where a doctor could, in fact, put these people. So the officers are humanely trying to get them, rather than put them into Rikers, where 40% of the population of Rikers now is emotionally disturbed, where they're subject to all kinds of abuse in that facility. We're trying to get them to more humane hospital abuse. And so that's the dilemma that we're finding. The tools that are essential to police, the laws, we no longer, in many instances, have the law to work with. And we cannot encourage our officers to break the law and enforce them. The issue of when we do take somebody in, the balancing act, hospital, jail. Now, in terms of this administration's commitment to this issue, they are currently funding the training of 5,000 of my street officers, starting up in northern Manhattan, and eventually 10,000, for millions of dollars to provide 4 days of intensive custom design training to my police officers to deal with the emotionally disturbed. Those who are emotionally disturbed because of psychiatric issues, and those who are emotionally disturbed because of drug ingestion. And so the officers are being trained to discern the difference between the both. Is the person schizophrenic? Is the person having psychiatric problems because of other instances? Because every one of these things requires a different approach on the part of the officer. Each one requires a different approach. One approach, if too assertive, is going to result in a combative reaction. And so we are training them to recognize symptoms. Is the person autistic? How many times you see the headline, police abuse autistic child or autistic person, police abuse schizophrenic? So we're training our officers in this society that has so many of these issues, how to deal with these people on the street in a humane, de-escalated way. It is not easy. I'm as frustrated as you are. I have a neighborhood that has significant homeless problems. I have homeless shelters and treatment centers. And I live in one of the better areas of the East Side. I experience it every day as you do. And I'm frustrated with it, but we are working on it. And it is not for lack of commitment. It is not for lack of resources. We are a resource-rich city at this moment, thank God. But it is going to take time to deal within the laws we have to work with and the extent to which the problem has exploded. If you want to see a real problem, go to Los Angeles. You want to see a real problem, go to Washington, D.C. The homeless issue has become epidemic. And when we talk about homeless, we're not necessarily talking in this city, the severe stress by families of the homeless. We're talking about the street population. I think we all can agree the quality of life issue we're talking about is what we see in our neighborhoods on the street. This is a problem that has exploded in America. A lot of it has to do with the significant increase in drug use that we're now experiencing, but also that for 40 years we've neglected to deal adequately with the mentally ill. Starting in the 1970s, we literally have the residual effect that began in the 1970s. Probably won't even find the term homeless used in any great frequency until the 1970s, when we created the problem, when we created the institutions.
Commissioner, it sounds like you're saying, among other things, that one of the tools and strategies that led to success your first time as commissioner was the speed with which people could see visible changes. I mean, for a number of different reasons that you just described.
It was so bad back then. That woman that you described, she has a three-year-old child, so I think we can safely speculate she's in her 20s or 30s. Even if she was living in New York in the 90s, she would have been about 5 or 10 years old or so. So we probably had no recognition of how crazy the city was at that time. So our perspective is shaped by the reality of our world today. We are in one of the safest large cities in the world in this country, and at the same time that we have come to expect that safety and that permanence. So as this homeless problem has, it hasn't crept up on us, but my sense of it, it has exploded in the last 2 years. Not yet, only here. I went back to Los Angeles a couple of weeks ago. I couldn't believe, you know, 5 years since I left, how the already horrendous problem there had become a total nightmare to the city of Los Angeles. And I went to Seattle a couple of months ago. Seattle is it's like being in another world. No, this is an issue we are trying to grapple with. We have resources, we have leadership that's focused on it. We certainly have a police commissioner that is, my claim to fame is on cleaning up the subways, cleaning up the streets of Giuliani and 94. And I don't intend to lose that position now, the second time I go around as commissioner. We will address these issues, but we'll do it lawfully. And we'll do it where my offices feel that they can do it compassionately and have appropriate tools to do it.
Okay, we're going to ask the folks with mics to, if you have a question, make yourself known. Press people are going to hold off and a special session for you. Fred wanted to say something.
Just a quick question for Phil. Phil, what should Albany be doing in office? The laws that constrain the commissioner are made in Albany. What should Albany do to help to aid us in this problem?
Well, I think that we all know that when the Advantage program was launched about 5 years ago, that was a resource problem for federal homelessness. And the city moved forward. This issue just yesterday, sole purpose that because of the urgency of the issue that the mayor clearly recognizes, we're gonna move forward and take control. But certainly we are in conversation with our state partners, with our federal partners, and we want this conversation to continue, and we feel that we can reach agreements with them shortly and soon. But it is, because this crisis is happening across the country, it is driven by an economic reality of ever-increasing costs, lower wages, it is exploding in places. It requires an all-hands-on-deck approach, both on resources, programs, and if there are some laws that must be adjusted to help local officials compassionately serve those in need, others as well. But obviously, no entity can go it alone. And certainly, we look forward to strengthening our partnerships to do all we can, to address the homelessness issue.
Okay.
I would like to address this to the police commissioner. Mr. Commissioner, what, if any...
I'm sorry, I cannot see you.
I live on 57th Street and 3rd Avenue, and I'd like to know what, if any, is the responsibility of New York City storekeepers? I mean, this is way beyond a social conscience issue. There is a 24-hour Duane Reade on 57th Street and 3rd Avenue. Homeless people are always outside it. Some meander inside it and scare people half to death 24 hours a day. You have a Whole Foods that has an alcove area where homeless persons are sleeping in subway next to supermarket carts, and it's impossible to even go outside and walk your dogs without homeless people coming up to you and asking you for $5. What is the responsibility of storekeepers to try to get the situation under control?
Their responsibility would be pretty much the same as yours, that there are still tools available to the police to deal with aggressive begging. And a lot of what changed in 94 wasn't so much that the homeless or the begging population disappeared, but the extraordinarily aggressive behavior that had become so prolific in the 80s and 90s, the squeegee pests, for example. Squeegee pests were able to get rid of because they were in violation of laws, traffic laws, that allowed us to enforce getting them off the streets. So what I would suggest is, store owner, is somebody out there harassing your customers, you living in the neighborhood, walking your dog, and somebody's harassing you, the idea is to call the police, because if they are aggressively harassing, there are things that we, in fact, can do as far as enforcing some of the quality of life laws or the tools we have to work with. But my point is that it is not as broad-based as it once was in terms of the tools that we have in the toolkit. And in terms of your question about Albany, I think the frustration up there at the governor's level is the same frustration that the mayor has at this level, is that because of the constitutional actions by the courts, that trying to create meaningful legislation to deal with this is proving an extraordinarily difficult and frustrating task, because even as you write the law, they're continually shooting them down. We watch very closely court actions around the country on this issue, and consistently, efforts on the part of cities to write laws that are within the constitutional guidelines are being shot down left and right. Believe me, if somebody's up with the magic bullet, I'm going to load up every gun I have with it, but nobody has found it yet.
Yesterday, the mayor told us he wants to welcome Syrian refugees to New York. If we let in 1,000, if we know only a half or 1% of terrorists, we have 5 or 10 people in New York who want to kill us. In Paris, let's remember, it only took 2 terrorists to drive up to the stadium and fortunately alert French security to stop them. But 5 drove around the city with machine guns, with AK-47s, and killed 150 people about. 5 people can drive around New York City and do it. Ben Rhodes, the deputy secretary, ensures us that he can vet them. Police Commissioner Bratton, how are you going to vet these people?
Vetting is actually very difficult. Director of the FBI, Comey, and I had a discussion about this yesterday when we met, because the responsibility for the vetting will fall on him. The problem as it relates to a significant portion of the Syrian population, indeed some of the other immigrant populations, is they do not have documentation. There is no ability to get into Syria to confirm documentation that they might have. So in the millions of Syrian immigrants, the ability to identify those that might meet our standards of documentation for immigration into the United States, no matter how humanitarian we want to be, is going to be a very difficult situation. Because when Congress is requiring of the FBI director, can you guarantee that everybody you let in is not a terrorist or will not become a terrorist? We've already talked about the significance of sometimes it's not the first generation, but significantly, particularly the European experience, it's the second generation who are born and raised in that country or committed at a young age who have become radicalized. So the dilemma of the Syrian immigration issue, particularly in a country that is built on immigrants, and the huge number of immigrants that are in our city currently, 25% of the population were born elsewhere. This is an unresolved situation. Could people be screened adequately to come in? Certainly, but the amount of effort is going to be extraordinary. And the FBI is an organization that is currently already stretched to the limit just trying to deal with the terrorists, let alone trying to deal with an expanding pressure on them to guarantee that people that they have charged with screening are, in fact, not terrorists. But the documentation is so limited for so many.
So in other words, we'd be at risk if we let these people in, because you'd have to remove police officers from other...
There would be a potential risk. There's always a potential risk for anybody we're letting in from anywhere in the world. That's the reality. There is no, what Congress is demanding, an absolute guarantee. Life doesn't work that way.
Commissioner, I've been concerned to hear you say twice that there have been court decisions between your first stint as commissioner and now that have made it much more difficult to deal with the homeless situation, the panhandling situation. And I'm someone who worked in the nonprofit area with your administration, with the Giuliani administration in your first stint on those issues. I don't follow that area of law as closely as I used to, but it seems to me that the really bad court decisions were before your first stint, back in the 80s, the real civil libertarian decisions, and we were actually able to roll some of them back during your first term. The courts upheld the aggressive panhandling statute that you put through. My question is, how is it that we were able to maintain all of your accomplishments, and they were great accomplishments, in your first stint as commissioner through the end of 2013? What happened since then? Were there, I'm not aware of any major civil libertarian homeless rights decisions in the last 2 years, so, but maybe there were. And what's your
the street population of this city has increased, as it has increased in most major American cities. If you take a look at a report that Scott Stringer put out recently about the loss of hundreds of thousands of what we would describe as single-room occupancy types of dwellings in the city, as the incredible construction that's going on in every corner of the city, take a look, walk up most of your avenues, look at that second, third, fourth floor, those four-story buildings. Many of them are totally empty. Why? The owners are basically depopulating them so they can put up a 30 or 40 story office tower. So you have a whole complex system underway in which there is fewer and fewer housing for people. And we've seen many stories in the papers about people who are making $20,000, $25,000 a year, who are on the streets because they cannot find housing that would allow them to basically get off the street. So there's a whole complexity of issues really creating almost a perfect storm. But that's the point I made earlier about the, it's clear to everybody that that street population of homeless, what we describe as homeless, and many of them shelter resistant in some instances, many are mentally disturbed, and many are in fact not able to afford housing. That, and even some of what you see on the street are people who have housing, but they make their living by going out the street and begging. So it's a complex set of issues, and it's not just one size fits all, if you will. But there are more homeless out there. There are more shelter resistant, more people begging on the streets than there were. It's quite clear.
Commissioner Brennan, how would you gauge the level of morale in the police department right now, and how is that morale related to the level of homelessness in the city we've seen in the last 2 years?
I judge morale by the performance of the department and the fact that at the end of this year we will report the lowest amount of crime ever recorded in the history of the city, the modern history of the city. I look at the fact that complaints against my police officers are down dramatically. I look at the fact that they are working very hard to reduce the number of enforcement actions they have to take by the spectrum of tools available, admonition, summons, arrest, that they're using the lower spectrum more frequently, that I think around the department, with one singular exception at the moment, which is the dispute over pay, is pretty good. I have 35,000 officers, 17,000 civilians. The vast majority of them are in assignments where they want to be. Are they happy with their pay? A lot of them are not. But in terms of improving working conditions, and what's important to you, whether their morale is high or low, is what is happening in the sense of the area of importance that police exist for, crime being number one. Crime is at an all-time low, and it will be low this year. It will probably continue to go down again next year. And the issues of concern to them, when I came in as police commissioner, we did an exhaustive survey of those officers to identify morale issues. Cleanliness of police facilities, equipment to work with, pay issues I have no more dealing with, but we are cleaning up every one of the precinct station houses. We're buying all new vehicles. We bought the bulletproof vest that they were seeking. That everything I can do to deal with what they were complaining about, discipline systems and fairness of them, career opportunities, that we are addressing. So I think on my end, the morale is actually pretty good in terms of what they are delivering. And what they are delivering to you is the safest large city in America, whether it's a traditional crime or in the area of terrorism, certainly, which is of concern right at the moment, certainly front page shortage. But but even on the quality of life issue, that they are working very hard within the limits of the tools they have to work with to try and address that issue.
You know, before the next question, I wanted to mention the Manhattan Institute put out a study this morning, a short analysis of you had the 15 developments that were targeted for special enforcement, the action plan for neighborhood safety in public housing. And, you know, the short version of the finding is murders declined 25%, shootings declined 13% in the 15 developments, but are up slightly in the rest of NYCHA. Overall, very slightly. To what do you attribute that? I know there were a complex of different strategies that were all applied at the same time.
Jack Maple, the late great Jack Maple, had an expression that I always liked. You can expect what you inspect. The whole thrust of CompStat is to focus attention on crime, where's it happening, when's it happening, and put cops on the dots, put cops where the crime is occurring. And CompStat speeded up the process of identifying patterns. Those 15 developments at that particular time were our most prolific in terms of crime growth. So by putting cops on the dots, I've had with this mayor, as much as so many of you dislike this mayor, I've worked with a lot of mayors, I've never had such support from any mayor in terms of funding. There's nothing I look for that I don't get, so I get cops to put on those dots. And so one of the reasons why you're going to see the lowest crime here is because we have a lot to work with. Technology, equipment, facilities, tens of millions of dollars of training. We are in the process also this year of implementing the new neighborhood policing program designed by Chief O'Neill, the pilot precincts. And so what you saw in the projects, you're going to see precinct after precinct around the city as it rolls out, not only continue low crime rates, but increasing citizen satisfaction, not only in the polling we're doing, and we're going to be doing exhaustive polling, but the polling that the Siennas and the Quinnipiacs are doing. Now, my projection into next year, as those pilot programs, that neighborhood policing program, with all volunteer officers, being given better equipment, being given better assignments, going to produce significant results. And we're getting better at it all the time, and that's good news for New Yorkers, it's good news for the 60 million people that come here as tourists, that we are in a very well-resourced position to keep the successes of the last 25 years going.
Okay, we'll move this up.
Hi there. My question is for Advisor Walczak. I work with ACE programs for the homeless. We're a smaller nonprofit here in Soho, and we actually provide job training and job placement and street sweeping programs for homeless men and women, and eventually house them. We're seeing that there's a bit of a shortfall in awareness among the public about some of these smaller programs that are addressing these needs on a neighborhood and community level. Do you feel that the public also holds a responsibility to contribute in their local neighborhoods? And as well, do you have ideas or plans to endorse programs that are doing this kind of good work?
Well, certainly, I don't know about your specific program personally, but I'm happy to find you afterwards and chat more. I think that having multiple approaches to this issue is key. I think that we work every day to be responsive to the concern of the public. We also want to engage the public as partners in addressing these issues as much as we possibly can. But I do think that when it comes to the issue of homelessness, and specifically working in a responsible and deep way to ensure that the solutions that we're offering can deliver permanent success, not just temporary success, is the key, because we don't want to have a cycle where we're finding ourselves serving the same people over and over again. That's not good for the city, it's not good for the community, it's not good for those individuals. So we want to have a multi-layered approach and work with organizations like yours and others. And to the extent that we can engage the public more, we're happy to do so.
Okay, that is going to be the last word. Please join me in thanking our panelists, Jason Monty.